One time I was flying from London, England to Washington, D.C., bypassing Korea. Soon after I got on the BOA airline, soon as I sat down, flight attendant come ask me a question. She said, "Are you Chinese?" I said, "No." "Are you Japanese?" I said, "You never ask Korean, are you Chinese, are you Japanese?" I said, "No." She said, "What are you?" I told her I was Korean. She said, "You Asians all look alike." I told her, "You Caucasians all look alike to me also." But I told her there's a way she could tell the difference between Korean, Chinese, Japanese. She said, "Oh, how can you tell the difference?" "When you see a wealthy man on the street, that's Chinese." She said, "Oh." "When you see Asian on the street, you think he's a smart, intelligent Japanese." She said, "Oh." "When you see an Asian on the street, if you think he's good looking, he's handsome, he's a Korean." We are all Koreans right here. I have traveled companions with us this week. I had one man look like a Chinese, but he's Korean. He's the chairman of a Korea Forest Broadcasting Company steering committee. We have probably about 2,000 couples supporting FEBC ministry. And Mr. Chang, he's going to come and tell you, appreciate it for the weekend that he spent here, Mississippi. And he like here, I think he's going to immigrate to here if Donald Trump let him immigrate.
But as chairman of the steering committee of FEBC Korea, I feel terribly that we haven't been able to dedicate a building like this in Korea, but we are doing this here in Belhaven University.
그래서 어제 만찬 후에 목사님께 달려가서 죄송하다고 말씀을 드렸습니다.
So last night after dinner we had together, I went to him and apologized that this was so good. I'm sorry that it couldn't happen. First of all, in Korea.
제 생각은 한국에도 목사님 기념관이 세워지기를 간절히 바라는 바입니다.
But I am praying that one day, if God allows, there will be a Billy Kim Center in Korea as well.
오늘 그 지역에서 회장님께서 미국에 김정한 목사님 기념관이 세워진 것이 앞으로 한미 우호관계에 큰 역할을 할 것이라고 말씀을 하셨습니다.
Dr. John Gregory this morning mentioned that the dedication of this building, Billy Kim International Center, will continue to help the relationship between South Korea and America.
이제 미국에 김정한 목사님 기념관이 세워짐으로 인해서 한미 우호관계가 더욱 증진될 것은 물론이고 벨헤이븐 대학과 FEBC와 또 총장님과 목사님이 더욱 우호관계를 돈독히 하셔서 한국과 미국의 하나님의 복음 사역에 큰 역할을 할 것을 믿습니다.
As we celebrate this wonderful day together with you and the dedication of the building, we hope that God will continue to bless our relationships with you, your country, and with Belhaven University.
다시 한번 총장님과 여러분께 감사의 깊은 감사의 말씀을 드립니다. 벨헤이븐 대학과 총장님, 총장님과 또 함께하시는 모든 여러분들에게 하나님은 저희 함께하기를 기원합니다.
Thank you so much to all of you, and God bless you. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm going to say a few words and get out of the way because you came to hear music, not come to hear a preacher rattle too long. Isn't that right? Jesus left a model for workmen to follow. As Paul admonishes to the young Timothy in 2nd chapter of a book of Timothy, 2nd Timothy of 2nd chapter, verse 15, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that need not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Workmen must have a compassion for the lost world. Matthew 14:14, we find Jesus went forth and saw a great multitude and was moved with compassion. I'm sure all of us know we are living in a competitive world. It's a busy world. It's an unfriendly world. It is a poor world and a rich world. Competitive world, I'm saying, is during the Korean War, there's so many houseboys in all of the American soldier camp because we are devastated by war, bombing, killing. A lot of children have lost their parents. We have to move from one section of the city to another section. And if they have little transportation, they have to move all the way down to Busan. But I was not fortunate enough to go that far. But we went out to the mountain, maybe about 5-6 miles. And then communists took over my village, my community. They virtually took everything that we owned because they need the food for their soldiers. They need the ox cart and ox to carry all their ammunition and their supplies. They only move at nighttime. So when they invaded my hometown, they took everything virtually we owned. Therefore, all the children is displaced from the school. They cannot go to school. School is bombed. City is bombed 90%. And there was a devastation. So many of the little children roaming around barbed wire fence to the U.S. soldiers' camp, hoping to be get something to eat and something to drink. American soldiers are very, very generous. Soon as they see the little children, the orphan children, they are so generous, they are willing to give everything that they have. But of course, we want to have a chocolate candy bar, chewing gum, because we have never tasted up to that moment. Chocolate is something very rare for Korean people. One day, tall sergeant called us to come, and he wanted us to bring some wood. So we brought some wood. In exchange, he gave us chocolate, chewing gum, cigarette, soap, socks, and ration. That was a good day's of wage if you sold those at the black market. So next day we went again with a several friend of ours, and same thing, the same soldier wanted us to bring some wood. It was mid-December, very cold in Korea. So we brought some wood. This time we get more rations, we get more cigarettes, more soaps, and more chewing gums and more chocolate. This time, ration was a big or number 10 can. It was all in English. We didn't know what it was, so we opened up. It was a can of prune. We have never ate a can of prune, so we give it to the ox stall and let ox have a party for the prunes. Next day we went. Soldier asked me to watch the stove. So I watched the stove, put some wood in there. I saw one corner of the tent there, sleeping bags and blankets all wadded. So I dusted the sleeping bag and the blanket and I hung on the sun. I saw their boots was all muddy, so I shined the boots. And their biscuits, they haven't cleaned it yet. So I heat up the bucket of water. I clean the biscuits for them. They like my work, so they asked me to become their house boy. I worked about 1 week. Then the soldiers said, Chinese volunteer army was coming down, so they're going to have to retreat toward the southern part of Korea. They asked me to go with them, be their houseboy. So I came home. I asked my mom if I could go with the American soldier, learn some English. She said, if you want to get killed, go ahead. I never heard about being killed, but I did hear go ahead. So I ran and got on the back of the truck of American soldiers. We moved all the way down below Daegu, little town called Gyeongsan, Apple Orchard. We got there, we pitched the tent, my official house boy work began. There I met Sergeant Carl Powers from small mine town near St. Paul, Virginia. Sergeant Powers asked me, would you like to go to America? Dream of every Korean teenager, they want to go to America. Somebody asked me, how did you find out about America? I said, that's easy. One of the American soldiers had the sales robot catalog, and I memorized every page of that catalog. If America's that good, I will go. One day, Sergeant Powers showed me application from Bob Jones Academy in Greenville, South Carolina. He said, you sign right here. So I signed it. He filled in everything in there and sent it to school. 3 months later, I got acceptance letter from Bob Jones Academy. I got scared. I told Sergeant Powers I didn't want to go. He said, why? I cannot speak English. I'm too small. And my mother will not let me go because I'm leaving the family. Sergeant Powers looked at me and said, when you go to America, you can learn English. If you go to America, eat a lot of cheese and milk, drink a lot of milk and eat butter and biscuits, all that, you'll grow up. He said, I get a permission from your mom, so she let you go. Every excuse I offer, he would accept it. Finally, he got Jeep, got an interpreter, told me to get in a Jeep, so I got Jeep. They drove to my house and just joined the Korean War. When Jeep pulled in a farm village, people thought General MacArthur was coming in. Everybody came out. Sergeant Powers, interpreter, my oldest brother, my mother. Sergeant Powers was asking my mom's permission to take her youngest boy to the United States. After a day-long conversation, my mom said, I'm old. I was born when she was 43 years old. Now I'm 15, going on 16. She's almost reached her age of 60. What about if I don't see him before he comes back to Korea and I may die? Sergeant Power told my mother, ma'am, I believe you'll live 15 more years. You'll see your son come back after he gets education from the United States. When she heard Sergeant Kara Power said, you'll live 15 more years, she said, go ahead, take it. So Kara and I did the paperwork. I got passport and visa. Sergeant Powers bought me ticket from Busan to San Francisco. He gave me $100 in greenback. I saved up $30. I was ready to get on the boat. He gave me a little name tag here by an army uniform. It says, to whom it may concern, send this boy to Route 1, Box 75, Dent, Virginia. He told me if you get lost, just show that name tag. American, very gracious, they'll take you to Dent, Virginia. I came to San Francisco. I was met by some soldiers. I stayed in their house for 3 weeks. I want to go back to school. They call back and forth. Finally, they said they are ready to receive me. Well, so Sergeant Power told Lieutenant Hine in San Francisco, send him on. So Lieutenant Hine took me to this bus depot, tried to buy a ticket. Ticket agent looked at me. He said, can he speak English? Lieutenant Hine said, no, he cannot speak English. I thought I spoke good English, and come to find out, only English that I learned was American used curse words when they were during the Korean War. And when I got here, I couldn't use those languages, so I didn't have much to go on. So the ticket agent won't sell me the ticket because he had transferred several places in the United States before I got to Virginia. So he took me to the train station. Virtually, they said the same thing. Finally, he asked me, how much money you have? I said, I have $130. That won't be enough to go across an airplane. So he looked at for a few minutes. You look small enough compared to American children, 11 years old. I was 16, going on 17. At that time, under 12 years of age, you get a half fare on an airplane. So Lieutenant Hines said, I'm going to get you half fare. If they ask you how old you are, just tell them you don't understand English. So I got on a TWA airline, I flew across on the half fare, $78. They never found out how old I was. But incidentally, after I became a Christian, I made restitution. Just before I went back to Korea, I went to TWA counter in San Francisco. I told them, 9 years ago, I rode your airplane to go to East Coast. I should be riding on a full fare, but I got half fare. I want to pay back what I owe you. Ticket agent looked at me, he said, what did you say? And I told him the same thing. He said, you wait a minute. He got assistant manager, you tell him. So I told assistant manager the same story. He said, wait a minute. He got manager. He said, you tell the manager. After they talked a long time, they said, since you're going back for good missionary cause, TWA airline will just donate to you that amount of money. So I made a restitution. I went back to Korea. But before that, I got converted at Bob Jones Academy. I want to study political science and go back to Korea, become a politician, because my family is so poor. We ate barley all the time, and I didn't want to eat barley the rest of my life. And I know well enough, if I become a politician, I don't have to eat barley the rest of my life. So I want to study political science. One day I was walking across that campus. God impressed upon my heart. He said, your country, there's so many politicians, they don't need you. But I need you to go back to tell your people, your family, about the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. So I graduated, went into the ministerial course, studied Bible, finished undergraduate, finished graduate. And by then, I feel like I need to get married. So I looked around, there wasn't any Korean girl at Bob Jones at that time. And I heard there's one girl's coming to study at Bob Jones. So I waited, come to find out, there's a 43 years old man came to Baltimore who's to study. I said, she's not for me. Then there's a little girl from Michigan waiting at our table. Soon as food is all gone, she run in the back of the kitchen, brought some more food. And I felt to myself, well, if I married that girl, I never would start. So I asked for a date, we dated for 4 years. Finally, we got married, we went back. Wonderful privilege to win my mother, my brothers and sisters, all their children, entire Kim family, come to trust Christ as their own personal Savior. Story doesn't end there. After I was converted to Bob Jones, I went back to Virginia, Sergeant Carl Powers home. I said, Carl, something wonderful happened to me at Bob Jones. He said, what? I opened my heart to receive Christ. Sergeant Powers said, you know, I've never done that. That afternoon, after we mowed the back lawn, he said, I will accept Christ. So he opened his heart to receive Christ. Several years later, our family is going to spend 1 week in Holy Land because our oldest son is going to go to Bible school here in the United States, and I'm going to show him all the place in Holy Land. So I wrote a letter. By this time, Sergeant Powers was teaching public school in his hometown. I said, Carl, our family should spend 1 week in Holy Land during the Christmas holiday. We loved you, we love for you to join us, and it will make us real happy. He wrote me a letter. He said, since I've been Christian, I've never been baptized. If you promise me you'll baptize me in River Jordan, I will come. On 1979, Christmas, day before Christmas, he flew to Tel Aviv. So we went out to meet him, and next morning, Christmas Day, we drove all the way to the Sea of Galilee, where the Jordan River started. There's a great big pool where you could baptize people. I took Sergeant Carl Powers, who meant so much to me. He went beyond the call of duty of his country. Paid my education for 9 years. I was taking him in to baptize him. The fellow just translated, John Kim. He was 11 years old. He said, Dad, I've never been baptized. I want to be baptized with Uncle Carl. Truly, Joseph Mary Kay was watching at the riverbank. And I had the privilege of baptizing Sergeant Carl Powers, who went beyond the call of duty of his country to befriend a houseboy, brought him to this country, give him an education, send him back to his own people, so his people will come to hear the wonderful story of saving grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. After I baptized John. And with man, this is impossible. But with God, all things are possible. These children came, they paid their own way, just to say thank you to America and American people, and just to say God bless America. And I'm sure one of the little girls gonna speak little English, express on behalf of all the children that I brought here, 500 of them. They're in 10 different cities, today, yesterday, tomorrow, singing to the American people, God bless America. Enjoy children's choir. God bless, thank you, Dr. Parrott. And I want you to bring your children's choir, 500, to Korea, and we will set up the meeting.
Thank you. 120 years ago, our country was in darkness and despair. Neighbor nations tried to take advantage of us, but God sent American missionaries to give us hope. They shined the light of the gospel and told us that God cares for you.
In 1950, our country was in trouble again.
Communists attacked our nation, invaded our country, and shattered our peace. American soldiers came to Korea to restore our freedom, many of whom died while fighting to help us. They told us by their actions that God loves you. On September 11th of 2001, the American people and the freedom you cherish was under attack. But we saw how you rose from the ashes of that disaster with a renewed hope in God. In the moment of your deepest pain, America returned to God through prayer and repentance. Now we hope to stand together as brothers and sisters in the Far East Broadcasting Company, Korea. We stand here with you to say, God bless America.
Thank you. Oh. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Come, Sammy. It was 66 years ago today that President Truman sent the troops to Korea to save this country. 66 years ago today, June 27th. And this is what the Americans fought for. We're so thankful. We love you. We are so thankful for you. And we just pray God's very blessed for you. Now this morning at 5 o'clock, my wife and I left the house with our daughter to put her on a plane to Korea for a month of study. She's a senior here at Belhaven University, and she's going to our sister institution, Seoul University, for a month of study. And so that's what I needed tonight, was a hug from 100 Korean kids. So thank you. I appreciate it. We all needed a hug from 100 Korean kids. Thank you for coming tonight. God bless you.